Yes, now, okay.
Okay, fantastic. All right, so good morning, everyone. I'd like to discuss magnetic exchange and exchange restriction from Vania 90 and DKW. This is the work that has been done by basically a number of people from my group. I'd like to particularly acknowledge Ryota Ono, who was there at the conference. Also, you had the chance to interact with him. And Aditya Putatunda contributed to some of the results. And then some of the results that I will be discussing were also resulted from the work of Francesco Fagetti, Margherita Parodi, Ravik Kaushik, and the former colleagues Louis Panet and Hong Chen, that are, who are now, who finished basically in this group and are now working elsewhere. I'd like also to acknowledge senior colleagues' useful discussions with David Vanderbilt and Feliciano Giustino. So the motivation for my talk is that in many situations, the systems that are most interesting where interesting magnetic states and transitions are observed are the frustrated ones, where the exchange interactions compete. Especially when non-trivial exchange interactions are there, the non-isotropic ones, such as Ising and Kitaev exchanges that are induced by strong spin orbit coupling, as well as Zawaszynski. And so on this slide, I show a unit cell of nickel telluride. This material at different fields has a range of different magnetic states. And the magnetic Zeeman energy is actually the lowest energy scale in the system. So you see this lowest energy scale by just switching magnetic field a little bit. You can switch between those, closely degenerate states and get all these different spin states. So in this system, to reproduce the correct ground state, one actually needs to include five different nearest neighbor exchange interactions. And so what is crucial to understanding the physics of this material, it's a giant magnetoelectric effect. And this material has the largest magnetoelectric effect of single phase compounds. Following suggestion of David Vanderbilt, is looking at the barrier between the two different states. Turns out that the fourth order anisotropy, so single ion fourth order anisotropy, cosine force phi, is basically responsible for whether the transition is going to be continuous or first order. And so when the magnetic field is ramped up or down in this antiferromagnetic material, a spin flop transition happens. So the transition between theta equals zero, so all spins vertical, and theta equals pi half, where spins are perpendicular to the field in the candidate state. And so depending on this fourth order anisotropy that determines whether there is a barrier between these two states at the switching field, or if there is a well, right? That guides the state in different ways. If there is a well, then the state just goes from a collinear state to a candidate one in a continuous fashion. There is basically two second order phase transitions corresponding to the appearance of the perpendicular order parameter and then disappearance of the parallel one. And then on the other hand, if the fourth order anisotropy has an opposite sign, then a barrier appears and the transition happens in the first order fashion. So giant magnetoelectric effect in this material is due to the fact that really the anisotropy is of this type, right? And then within a narrow field range, the large polarization change is driven by the magnetic exchange restriction. So you see that anisotropic interactions and the ability to compute exchange constants rather precisely is really crucial to correctly predict with physics. This was ENCON 2014. Let me say a few words just to motivate the discussion. So Anderson super exchange is basically the energy gain on the hopping that kinetic energy gain essentially on the hopping between the transition metal orbitals. Typical situation is when metal ions are bridged by the oxygen, or can be halide ions, something like this. And then typical Hamiltonian that people consider is a kind of Kanamori Hamiltonian that includes Hubbard term and the Kuhn's rule couplings. And then there are hoppings between the transition metal sites and oxygens. Then essentially in the ferromagnetic state for a single orbital model, Pauli principle precludes hopping, but in antiferromagnetic state, hopping is possible and the energy gain is proportional to T square over U. On the other hand, ferromagnetic exchange is very rare and the ferromagnetic insulators are very difficult to find. Most of the ferromagnetic insulators, they are really ferrimagnetic. This is because the ferromagnetic exchange comes from the 90-degree bond, where basically hopping happens to the orthogonal orbitals of the oxygen. And so essentially one can think of this in the following way. P orbitals are completely occupied on oxygen, so it's P6. And then these electrons on the oxygen, they can hop on the transition metal sites. When the two electrons of the same spin hop to these transition metal sites, then the two electrons of the opposite spin remain. And this configuration is favored by the Hund's rule coupling on oxygen. So because Hund's rule coupling on oxygen is usually not very large, that gives rise to the weakness of this contribution. So this is one of the typical mechanisms. So again, I mean, for a dimer, spin one, spins cannot hop, and the spin zero on a dimer, up down minus down up, there is energy gain 40 square over U. And so then one can introduce this spin exchange operator, computing the energy in the second order perturbation theory in T. So we are diagonalizing U in the Baer Hamiltonian, and then we are doing perturbation theory in T. Then as we hop the electrons from one side to another, we come back to the situation when we exchange the electrons, we come back to the situation where basically the wave function is the same up to a sign. Indeed, if the electrons, if initial state was a triplet, let's say up down plus down up, then by exchanging electrons, you get up down plus down up again, right? So here you are coming back to the same state for a triplet, but for a singlet, you are coming back to the from up down minus down up, you are coming back to minus that state, right? Because you change the spin. And so minus sign gives rise to the minus here. So then that is encoded into this in this spin exchange operator. 2s1 s2 plus 1/2 that one can check is +1 for a triplet and -1 for a singlet. So this spin exchange operator keeps track of this sign essentially. And so then the energy, second order perturbation energy, turns out to be this way. Okay, now Dzhevashinsky-Maria is also microscopically arising in a similar way, but spin orbit coupling is involved. In the simplest, so spin orbit coupling can be large both on transition metal ions, but also on the ligands. For example, in iodide and bromine compounds, it was recently shown by work of several groups, Silvia Picozzi, one of them. Showed that there are large anisotropic interactions due to strong spin orbit coupling on the ligands. And so basically one can sketch the process in the following way. You have two perpendicular orbitals on the transition metal sides, and usual exchange is going from yellow to yellow, and then from second electron goes from this yellow back to that one. In the Dzhevashinsky-Maria process, however, spin orbit coupling assists the transition of the electron between yellow orbital and the green one. All right. And then hopping happens from the yellow orbital to the green one on the other side. In the unbent bond, in the symmetric configuration, this green orbital is orthogonal to the yellow one, so the hopping is zero. So that's why the Wyszynski-Maria normally happens when the bond is bent. And so it involves basically contributions of the spin orbit coupling, right? And then hopping between these wrong orbitals, and then hopping of this electron here to the orbital on the left. So then basically the same story. There is again this minus one factor encoded by spin exchange operator, but there is also L dot S. And so then you compute the matrix elements of L dot S. L operator is minus I nabla, right? So between XY, XZ, YZ, real orbitals, it's completely imaginary because of minus I nabla. Right, so then when you add the Hermitian conjugate term, this becomes a minus, and then so you get essentially S12 S1 minus S1 S12. Then that gives rise to a trivial commutator of spin exchange operator with a spin, right? SISJ equals E to the ABC SC, and that gives rise to the vector product. So in this trivial way, we can get very quickly the Wyszynski-Maria. And so what we see here is that it's crucial that spin orbit coupling is strong, that there is a hopping to the wrong orbital facilitated by the bond bending. And then you see that it's actually very important. The distortion is very important, right? Because the distortion of the bond controls directly this exchange energy. So this D is controlled directly by the bond distortion. So normal Anderson super exchange and also the Wyszynski-Maria and the symmetric anisotropy, they are all strongly dependent on the orbital overlaps and the bond geometry. And so in the ultra fast experiments and also in multi ferroics, in physics of magnetoelectric coupling, it's very important therefore to understand and be able to quantify the connection between parameters of the magnetic Hamiltonian, such as D and J, and the ionic displacements. This coupling between spins and ionic displacements gives rise to spiral multiferroics, particularly if you just consider a frustrated chain with a ferromagnetic nearest neighbor and antiferromagnetic next nearest neighbor, that gives rise to spiral states. And so when I do the inversion, let's say around this point, then the spins don't change under inversion. So this spin goes here, pointing the same way. So you see that spiral breaks inversion symmetry, and thus gives rise to polarization in this case. Doesn't always have to, but in this case it does. It's possible also to break inversion and not in this polarization, but in this case, polarization arises. It's proportional, its direction is given by the spin rotation vector and the wave vector of the spiral. And so again, you see it's the basically inverse the Wyszynski-Maria, so the coupling of spins to the displacement of oxygen is what drives the polarization. So once spins are non-collinear because of J1, J2, polarization arises to optimize this term. Okay, then how to approach this problem? So starting from 1987, Liechtenstein formula has been proposed. In this paper by Liechtenstein, Kasnelson, Antropov, and Gubanov, they suggested to compute second order correction to the energy of the magnet due to rotation of the two spins. So they take two spins in the unit cell, rotate one by some small angle, another by another small angle. It turns out that the energy correction is proportional to d phi 1, d phi 2. And then the second derivative is extracted from the basically bubble-like diagram with the deltas, the kind of exchange operators in the vertices. So then exchange can be computed this way, with the Liechtenstein formula. This has been implemented in a number of codes, also using Vanier basis. So I think in AMOLED code, it appeared around 2010. And then, if I understand correctly, then there was this paper that uses it with ODA plus U. More recently, TB2J code implemented it, and then there is also OpenMX that implements similar methodology. And I also saw several talks at this conference that discussed this method. What would we like to do is basically to add the dependence of the Green's functions on the ionic displacements, right? So essentially here you have 1 over omega minus h, and h, the Hamiltonian, through the dependence of Tij, depends on ionic displacements. So essentially the formula for the exchange, basically you just take this g delta g delta formula, insert in the denominator 1 over h hopping plus h electron phonon, and then you get essentially in the first order this diagram where the first upper and lower Green's functions can be corrected by the electron phonon coupling by interaction with this frozen phonon in the system, right? The ionic displacement. So you get basically formula g delta g delta g h electron phonon, and h electron phonon is conveniently implemented in EPW, where it's really implemented in the Vanier basis. So the electron phonon coupling in the Vanier basis basically tells us the change of the hopping essentially between the orbitals 0 and r due to the potential induced by displacement of the ion elsewhere. Right, can be one of these ions or ion somewhere else in the lattice. And so this basically gives directly this coveted correction. Another important part of the story is that if I write this simple super exchange formula, there is dt over du times du, and then there is also a variation of Hubbard u or the gap, right, due to the shift of ion. So far, we haven't looked into this in detail, and we use the fact that in centrosymmetric environment, basically shifting ion to the left or right has to give rise to the same change of delta of u. All right, so that means that correction to u in a centrosymmetric environment, at least, is quadratic in the displacement. So if the ion is at the inversion center, initially you don't have to consider that in the first order. But that would be another very important point. So this is basically work of Riotto Ono. So the point here is that magnetoelectric coupling is really coupling between spins and ionic displacements comes from the dependence of the exchange matrix. So there is basically S times the matrix of exchanges that depends on U in this following way on the ionic displacements to the first order. And so optimizing, so changing the ionic displacements leads to change of the exchange matrix, and then spins rotate that leads to the change of magnetization. Okay. So one particular case I would like to discuss of the use of this formula is type 1 multiferroics. So multiferroics, the materials with coexisting electric and magnetic orders, they have been studied for a long time. And basically in type 1 multiferroics, ferroelectricity and magnetism coexist, but they are not induced by each other. So they are weakly interacting, and so for a long time, so these materials are not considered as promising as a type 2 multiferroics, where magnetism induces ferroelectricity. On the other hand, it turns out that in these materials, type 1 multiferroics, while there may not be a strong magnetoelectric coupling in the bulk, nevertheless, at domain walls, there may be a strong coupling. Let's consider a ferroelectric domain wall. The amplitude versus the site index is shown in this plot. So I have polarization downwards, and then polarization zero at the domain wall, and then polarization changes to upwards. This is schematic situation. So in a double well potential for polarization, so imagine some tetragonal crystal. This corresponds to the following. So minimum in the left well, then it's in the center at the domain wall, and then on the right. So polarization, so the polar distortion of the lattice changes this way. So it turns out that this change of this ferroelectric mode along the spatial coordinate also leads to the bond bending and the changes in the Tij. And that leads to the modulation of exchange in the following way. So at the ferroelectric domain wall, exchange versus site index, exchange changes slightly. However, the leads that effect, the change of exchange, leads to actually the dependence of the energy of magnetic domain wall on the coordinate, right? Magnetic domain wall in this case turns out to be cheaper here at the ferroelectric one. So that produces an attractive potential between the ferroelectric wall and the magnetic one. Now, magnetic walls are usually rather wide, and so Pyros-Navarro barriers that pin them to the lattice are often rather small. So that is to say, magnetic walls are very mobile, which leads to the fact that it's probably easy to move the magnetic domain walls by moving ferroelectric ones. Even if there is no coupling, no magnetoelectric coupling in the bulk, this effect, change of exchanges at the ferroelectric wall, will still try to convince the magnetic wall to move along. And this seems to be consistent with the observation by Fibich and et al. Nature 2002, where they demonstrate the clamping of ferroelectric and antiferromagnetic walls. So basically, you take any structural wall, can be ferrodistortive ordering, whatever, ferroelastic, anything. And then if that modifies exchanges, that will likely pin magnetic domain walls, not necessarily ferromagnetic, but also antiferromagnetic ones. Okay, so in conclusion, the exchange restriction can be calculated using electron-phonon coupling, and really it seems that it's just Liechtenstein formula plus electron-phonon interactions. And then one problem that is not resolved yet is the corrections to U due to the ionic shifts in the non-centrosymmetric environment. And with that, I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sergey, for a very nice talk. Any questions from the audience? So maybe I can ask a question. So how do you deal? So which functionals do you use for these magnetic states? It looks like there are a lot of. So it's mostly LDA plus U, or?
Yeah, right. That's a good question. So it turns out that actually reproducing the ground states even is not very trivial. For nickel telluride that I talked about first, with LDA, like PbSO plus U, we cannot even get the correct ground state. It turns out that PB0 works rather well. At least, I mean, one can get to the correct ground state without any tuning of exchanges. And then, right, I mean, so the gap seems to be crucial, like getting the right experimental gap seems to be very important because it controls the intermediate states that that the hopping brings to. So indeed, exchange correlation is very important.
So do you think that's just specific for this system, or would it be generally true also, or?
Right, I mean, especially, let's say if in an frustrated system where just ferromagnetic exchanges are there, right, that wouldn't be qualitatively hurting us. But where there is a subtle interplay between different exchanges, getting them wrong really changes the picture, like makes it impossible to reproduce the correct phase diagram.
So it's PB0 without, so just PB0, you don't add U, right? Or you do both? Or?
Right. PB0 opens the correct gap, basically.
But you don't have to add U, right?
No, I mean, with LDA plus U, we couldn't get the same exchanges. We tried different values of U.
Okay.
Even if we get the gap consistent with PB0, right? The same gap as in PB0 with plus U, we still don't get the same exchanges because the curvatures of the bands are different.
Okay.
And the TIJs are different. So some subtle interplay.
Okay, thanks. Some other questions? So maybe I can ask another. So this Liechtenstein approach, is that available in any code that I can just like download and use? Or is this kind of personal repositories?
No. So in principle, so let's say TB2J implements it. I think Abinit also implements it just from scratch now. There is a bunch of codes that does this. And then we also have like a C version of it that we were basically writing to expand on it to get to the strong spin-orbit coupling. So, there is a story where different... So in the materials with strong spin-orbit coupling, so like routinates and iridates, there can be a significant angle between the orbital angle momentum and spin angle momentum. And basically, you can kind of in some strontium routinate, I think it's like 40 degrees. So then it makes sense to try to define like different exchanges like between L and S on different sides. This was work of Lipanet. But there is also a simpler version for low spin orbit coupling that's also available in C and in Julia. We can share it. We didn't share it, I think, openly because there are these other codes that basically do it.
So you think that TB2J is the kind of the most, user friendly for somebody who wants to get into this type of calculations? TB2J?
Yeah, well, right. Also this amulet is basically working with quantum espresso. So.
Okay. Okay, we have a question over there.
So just a curiosity, because the Liechtenstein approach was initially suggested for KKR approaches. And now the nice thing of the Vanier approach is that you can somehow still get an atomic limit for and get in this way the JIJ between two atomic sites. But Vanier functions are typically not super localized on just a given atom. And in particular, if you Vanierize the same system by including more or less bands, you might have that Vanier functions are more or less extended. How these affects actually this the exchange coupling between atoms?
Right. Yes. So we also did the tests with a different number of bands. So just Vanierizing a large window, including more and more of the deeper levels of ligands. And it turns out that exchange is changing. It seems that the window of 30 eV below the Fermi level gives us exchange to 0.1 millivolt. There is energy denominator, right? That comes from the G delta.
I think the question was more about empty states, right? Like, what if you change the...
No, just on the localization of the wave function, the Vanier functions in themselves.
Yeah, but if you add like deep states 30 eV below, maybe that doesn't change that localization. But if you add empty states, maybe that will change it more. Yeah, so did you try to add more empty states or?
No, right. So we do. We do add the empty and occupied states, basically plus minus 30 eV.
Oh, so you did both.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thanks.
Other questions? No?
Okay, so let's thank Sergey again.
Thank you.
So